Welcome to New Hope Online. We are so grateful that you have chosen to watch our message today. And the title of my message today is Love, Marriage Problems, and How to Solve Them. Love, Marriage Problems, and How to Solve Them. I've been teaching from the book of the Song of Solomon in the Old Testament for the past 2 weeks. If you will recall, on Valentine's Day, I gave a message on maintaining and building healthy relationships. And then last week, I gave a message on reboot your marriage. And today is the final message in this mini series from the Song of Solomon, talking about love, marriage problems, and how to solve them. You know what I've learned over these long years of pastoring? I've learned that most people, you know what they want from preaching? They just want ammunition for what they already believe. They just want to hear ammunition for what they already believe. That's true, folks. And it's okay if he or she is preaching what you already believe. But when the preacher says something that is contrary to what you already believe, then we have a problem with that. Because it seems like a lot of times we only want to hear ammunition for what we already believe. And sometimes when we give a teaching out of Scripture and it challenges our thinking, our theology, we tend to shrug it off. But I want you to know that what I teach is right out of the Word of God. And I want to share in all of my messages, what does God say about a certain situation? And all I want to do, folks, in my teaching, is just share with you what God's Word says. I want you to know your Bible, and I'll be the first to admit that sometimes you come to church and the message, well, it really isn't applicable to you. But maybe later on it will be. Or you may know someone in your relational world that could use the message, and so you can pass it on, because all of my teaching is based upon transferable concepts. And so sometimes a question is asked, Dale, we shouldn't be talking about this. Well, let me ask you a question. If the Bible talks about it, can't we talk about it in church? If God's Word talks about it, and we can't talk about it in God's church, then we are in a sad, sad situation, folks. We've got to share what God's Word says. And folks, I'm not smart enough to preach anything but the Bible. That's it. But I'm too smart to preach anything but the Bible. It's what the Word of God says, folks, that really matters. Now, the message from the Song of Solomon is a love story between Solomon and Shulamite. And so let's open our Bibles to the book of the Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verses 2 and 3. And so whatever you use to read and study God's Word, let's turn to this thrilling love story in the Song of Solomon. Look what it says. Verse 2, I sleep, but my heart waketh. It's the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled, for my head is filled with dew, and my locks with the drops of the night. Verse 3, Shulamite speaks, I have put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? Folks, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, as we bow our heads and our hearts in your presence today, I pray that you would speak to us and through us. I pray, Lord, that you would help us to open our heart and our minds, and may your word find a lodging place in the hearts of people today. We praise you, Lord, for all you do, and we praise you for being so good to us. And I pray with a grateful heart, a thankful heart, and in the name of Jesus, amen. Talking to you today about love, marriage problems, and how to solve them. The story goes this way. An angel one time said to Adam, Adam, I have a proposition for you. Adam said to the angel, well, what is a proposition? And the angel said, Adam, I am going to give you a woman. Adam said, well, what is a woman? And the angel said, I want to give you she. And Adam said, what will she do? And the angel said, well, Adam, when you've been out working in the garden all day and you come home tired, she's going to meet you at the door. She's going to be beautifully dressed. She's going to be wearing perfume, and she's going to meet you at the door, and when you open the door, you will smell the aroma of a delicious meal that's prepared for you. She's a great cook, Adam, and she's not one of these Pillsbury cooks. Do you know what a Pillsbury cook is? Well, it's one of those cooks where you better take a pill before you eat the meal, or else they will bury you. Well, she's not a Pillsbury cook. She is a gourmet cook, Adam, and you're going to have a great, delicious meal. After you have your meal, Adam, she's going to tell you that she wants you to move into the other family room, and she is going to give you a massage. She's going to weave her hands and her fingers over your tired muscles. She's going to caress your muscles. And it's going to be so wonderful, Adam. She'll make you feel relaxed. And then after that, Adam, guess what's next? You're going to be seated in your Lazy Boy recliner, and you will have something special happen to you. Whatever you will request, she will be Johnny on the spot, and she will be right there, and she's going to get it for you. Adam said, wow, this is really amazing. Now let me ask you something. What's this going to cost me? And the angel said, it's going to cost you an arm and a leg. Adam went, huh. What can I get for a real? Well, one couple in their early years of marriage was having kind of an intense dialogue. And he said to her, I wish you could make biscuits like my mama did. She replied, well, I wish you could bring home the dough like my daddy did. Sometimes a person, a couple will say, our marriage is made in heaven. You know what my response to that is? So is thunder and lightning. They're made in heaven. You know, folks, I'll promise you this. A relationship starts out in dating, and it's an ideal relationship. You put your best foot forward, and you say, he is so wonderful, and she is so precious. They're not really so wonderful and so precious, because the real person is back home in a cage. It's just the dating. We start out, and it's ideal. We get married, still an ideal, but after a while, we've got an ordeal on our hands. It may start out as an ideal, but in every relationship, there will be an ordeal. And even though it starts out ideal, it will be confronted with an ordeal. Many times it'll be many ordeals, but we want to make sure you don't reach a point where you are looking for a new deal. Now, we want to make sure that you are willing to stick it out. Now, folks, I've been studying Solomon for quite a while, and this book is a love story. It also is an allegory between God and the nation Israel, but I'm focusing in this series upon the love relationship between Solomon and Shulamite. And you read through the first three or four chapters, and it's just wonderful. You find a couple that is passionately in love. They really are, and they are passionately expressing their love for one another, but something happens in chapter 5. They start having problems. They move from the ideal, now they have an ordeal, and that's what we want to talk about today. We want to talk about problem solving, and this is what I know. I've got problems, you've got problems, all of God's children have problems. It's life 101, and so there will be an ordeal, and there's an ordeal that pops up occasionally, and Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, and his beautiful bride, Shulamite, they ran into an ordeal. Let's look at their problem. There are just three things I want you to see. Number one, let's see the cause. Here's the cause. And let's just read the story and let the story speak for itself. The Shulamite, the wife, the bride, here's what she said in verse 2. I sleep. So she's in bed. She's asleep. And she says, my heart waketh. It's the voice of Solomon, my beloved, that knocketh, saying, okay, now let's look at what Solomon had to say. Here's what he said. Open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled, smooth-talking guy. Isn't Solomon at this point? Here's Shulamite. She's in bed. Solomon speaks to her, wakes her up. My love, my dove, my undefiled. Now, folks, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out at this point what's on his mind. You don't have to have a theology degree to figure this one out. You don't have to know Greek and Hebrew to figure this one out. Solomon said, for my head is filled with dew. He's been outside. He comes inside. My locks are filled with the drops of the night. So you can see where he is trying to go. But look, here's what she says at verse 3. She says, I have put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? Here's what she was saying to Solomon. Solomon, I am ready to go to sleep. Solomon, I am not interested in what you are interested at this time. Now, folks, she just said, Solomon, I want to go to sleep. Now, how many of us have known, folks, a scenario played out like that? Sure, most of us have. This is real life, folks. But she wasn't interested. And so let me make a statement. This is so important. I want you to understand something. I'm going to talk about it because God talks about it in His Word. Marriage is God's provision for the physical fulfillment. Or better to say, marriage is God's provision for the sexual relationship. Folks, it's the way that God planned it. It's important that it is within the parameters of God's provision. Now, I know some may not enjoy this message, but I want you to understand something, folks. I'm just a mailman. I'm just delivering the mail, and I am interested in what God has to say about marriage. What does His Word say? And I'm just delivering the mail to you, folks. So, I want to share, what does God say about marriage? Because marriage is God's provision for the physical, sexual relationship. Now, there's three things I want you to see in this chapter. First of all, I want you to see the permanency. I want you to see the permanency. See, when a marriage is consummated, the two become one flesh. They become one flesh emotionally. They become one flesh spiritually. They become one flesh psychologically. And they literally become one flesh. They become one because, why? That's the way God planned it, folks. And it's meant to happen within the confines of marriage. Many times, young ladies, young men, but especially, I've noticed this more in young ladies, they become greatly confused when they step outside the parameters of God's provision. And they get messed up emotionally because something happens. And when it happens, psychologically, they get messed up, physically, spiritually, and sometimes even mentally, and they just don't know how to handle it. There's a connection that they really don't quite understand, and what they don't understand is this: the sexual relationship was meant to happen within the parameters of God's blueprint for marriage. It is to happen within the permanency of marriage. Let's look what the Bible says. Genesis chapter 2, verse 24. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. That's what God said. Those aren't my words, folks. That's what God said. Now get this, it is consummated. And God said when this happens, they literally become one flesh. Literally, they become one flesh. And look, here they were in the garden, and they were completely naked. This man and this wife were naked, and they weren't ashamed. They weren't guilty. They did not live with condemnation. Why? Because it was done God's way. And when you do it God's way, you don't have to live with guilt. You don't have to live with the condemnation. Now, folks, I know this is 2021, but God's Word is still God's Word in 2021. So I want you to see, first of all, the permanency. I want you to see something else. The relationship is not only about permanency, but it's about procreation. Procreation. Look what the Bible says, verse 27. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God created He him. Male and female created He them. And then He said, verse 28, and God blessed them. He put His blessings on them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. Got to understand something, folks. Marriage is about procreation. Now, I'm not going to be harsh in this message. My heart is full of compassion. It really is. I'm not trying to beat anybody up, but we've got to let the Bible be the Bible. What does God's Word say? Now, folks, marriage is about procreation. Now, two men cannot be fruitful and multiply. Two women can't be fruitful and multiply. Folks, we cannot redefine what God has already defined in His Word. We cannot redefine what God has already defined. All I'm going to say, folks, is let the Word of God be the Word of God. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 1, verse 27, and the men, instead of having normal sexual relationships with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of their sin, they suffered with themselves the penalty they deserved. I want you to understand something, folks. Some may be in an alternative lifestyle. And let me say something about that. I'm wise enough to know that I totally don't understand everything. I really don't. I'm not wise enough to know everything. I'm not here to try to beat people up. And I'm not here to be harsh with people. I'm simply, out of the compassionate heart that I have, trying to tell you what God's Word says. And I'm trying to tell you what God says about marriage. Procreation can only happen between a man and a woman. Now let me reiterate, I don't understand everything about every issue. I don't have all the answers. I don't understand totally. But here's what I would say. If you find yourself in a lifestyle that does not line up with God's Word and what God's Word teaches, you may say, Dale, well, is there any hope for me? What about my child? What about a family member? Is there any hope? And the answer is, yes, there is. I want to show you a scripture. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 and through 11. Don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin, or who worship idols, or commit adultery, or are male prostitutes, or practice homosexuality. Now, for a long time, this is where the church has stopped. We hoop and holler on this one issue, homosexuality. But God doesn't stop there. God goes on. He includes something else. Now, it's easy to take just one sin and beat somebody up with it and be harsh with them. But let's read on. God doesn't stop there. Look what He says in verse 10. Or thieves, greedy people, drunkards, or abusive, or those who cheat people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. But wait, look at this next verse. We're not beating people up, folks. That's not my intent. And we're not being harsh. But here is some wonderful news, good news, that you can use, and it's found in verse 11. Some of you were once like that. Let that sink in. Some of us were once like that. But you were cleansed. You were made holy. You were made right with God by calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Folks, God's Word does something that no man or woman can do. God's Word can change and transform a person's heart when they're open to receive the truth from God's Word. This verse 11, folks, this is a beautiful, beautiful picture of God's grace, God's mercy, and God's forgiveness. Talking about the confines of marriage. It's about permanency. It's about procreation. But let me give you another one. Number three, it's about pleasure. It's about pleasure. Now, there's a story of a woman in the Bible who was 75 years old. Her name is Sarah, and God told her that she's going to have a baby. Can you imagine that? 75 years old, God says, you're going to have a baby. Well, Sarah knows what has to take place for that to take place. And look what she said. Genesis 28, verse 12. So she laughed, first of all, and then she said, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure? Look what she said. Looks like I'm going to have pleasure again. I'm old, but it looks like I'm going to have pleasure. I found out something really interesting, folks, in my research. I do a lot of research for my messages, and I research the relationship between a man and a woman. And I researched how men are more driven, and I found out what was really, really interesting. Men are more driven on days that start with a T. Tuesday, Thursday, today, tomorrow, Saturday, and Sunday. It's true. In Red Book magazine, they had an article about the activities that men really enjoy in marriage. What do men really enjoy in marriage? 78% of men said the physical relationship. Well, what do women enjoy most in the marriage relationship? The men, 8 out of 10, said the best thing about marriage is a physical relationship. What did the women say about what was the best about a marriage relationship? What did they enjoy most about being married? 29% of women said they enjoy mostly a relaxing day on the beach. Men are 78% in the other direction. Women, 29% said they really enjoy spending a day on the beach. 28% of the women said they most enjoy in a marriage relationship a romantic dinner. A romantic dinner. Look, here's men, 78%. Women said only 9% said that the physical relationship was what they most enjoyed from a marriage. Men, 78%. Women, 9%. And then here's what really blew my circuits. 8% of the women said a piece of chocolate cake is the most satisfying thing in a marriage relationship. So the sexual relationship, from a woman's point of view, is just one point above a piece of chocolate cake. I mean, let's just be honest. Men are like a microwave. They really are. And women, well, they're just like a crock pot. That's just how we are wired. It's true. But folks, the Bible tells us something here. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 1 through 4. Look what it says. Now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me, it's good for a man not to touch a woman. Paul said it would be best if a man would just stay single and not get married so he could focus on doing the work of the Lord. Most men cannot do that. Look what he said. Nevertheless, verse 2, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. You say, Dill, is that really what they're talking about? Is that what I'm thinking? Is that what they're really talking about? Yes, it is. Verse 4, The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband. Likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife. What she's trying to say here, folks, is we don't place demands upon one another. Our mate is not a piece of property, and we don't manipulate in our relationship. But God says something in verse 5, defraud you not one the other. Don't keep this from one another, he says, except it be with consent for a time. Now look, so that the enemy will tempt you. God brings couples together so the enemy won't tempt you. And the relationship is God's provision for you. They had a problem. Solomon and Shulamite did. There was a cause. Solomon comes and Shulamite says, I'm not interested in what you are interested at this time. I just want to turn over and go to sleep. So there was a cause. Then look, a chaos followed. Solomon comes up there and she says, no, I want to go to sleep. Solomon says, I go. It's a true story. He left. He split. Verse 6, he literally left. Sometimes in a marriage relationship, the problem, whatever it is, becomes so great and big, insurmountable, that a mate chooses to just withdraw and leave. Well, that's what happened here with Solomon. He's left, he split. Verse 6, he literally left. Question that we always are asked in the ministry, when is it right to leave? Well, let me tell you something. If there's physical abuse for you and your children, it's the right time to leave. I've said this several times over the years. God never meant for you to be a punching bag for someone else's expression of anger. If there's physical abuse, it's the right time for you or your children to leave. When's the right time, biblically speaking, to get a divorce? What does the Bible teach about that? What are the biblical grounds for getting a divorce? Two times, two grounds for biblical divorce. Number one, adultery, according to Matthew chapter 19 and verse 9. Adultery takes place. That's biblical grounds for divorce. But not only adultery, but abandonment. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 15. The Bible says, if an unbelieving spouse leaves, let him leave. When there's an unbelieving spouse who decides to leave, let him leave. Let him leave. Those are the only two biblical grounds for divorce. But there's another question. Some say, well, Bill, I've been divorced, but I really didn't have any biblical grounds for divorce. Is there any hope for me? And I say, with confidence, yes, there is. Look at 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, even if that is a divorce, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that includes divorce. All I want to say, folks, is that a divorce is not the unpardonable sin. It is not the unpardonable sin. God forgives people. God is in the restoration business, folks. God doesn't command divorce. God allows a divorce, but he doesn't command it. The perfect will of God is for families to stay together. That's the perfect will of God, for families to work through their problems, work through the situation, follow the dictates of the Word of God and stay together and fight for your families and work through the problems. So listen, here it is. They have a problem, Solomon and Shulamite. He leaves. But then there's a third thing I want you to see. I'm almost done. We've talked about the cause. We've talked about the chaos. I want you to see the cure. What is the cure? It's found in verse 6. Solomon speaking. Look what she says. Solomon, by the way, I meant to say, is gone. He's out of there. He left. Verse 6, Shulamite says, he left. But she said, I sought him. He left, but I went after him. You know, folks, sometimes I believe there are too many leaving and we're not going after them. Verse 6, I opened to my beloved, she says, but my beloved had withdrawn himself and was gone. He split. My soul failed when he spoke. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. Folks, that is an empty, empty, gut-wrenching feeling in the heart. Solomon is nowhere to be found. You know what she said? She said, I'm not going to give up on my marriage. I'm going to seek him out. He's left, but I'm going to find him. And she understood Nehemiah 4:14 when it says, fight for your marriage. Fight for your family, precisely is what it says in Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 14. Folks, if we don't fight for our family, if we don't fight for our marriage, guess what happens? The devil will sneak in and destroy your family, destroy your relationship. But here's what's really interesting. You know what she said? She said, I'm not going to give up on my marriage. There's a movement in our country today called Standing for Your Marriage. And she was going to do just that. I'm going to seek him out. He's left, but I'm going to find him. And if you study chapter 6, her friends said, we don't know where Solomon is. But she said, I know where he is. He's in the garden. Now, folks, if you've been married for any period of time, you begin to know how each other thinks. Ever been there? You know what each other thinks. You say to your wife, I think we'll go down to the Chinese restaurant for dinner tonight and eat. And she says, well, that's fine if that's what you want to do. Hold it. Put on the brakes. You should consult your wife. Honey, where do you go? Where do you want to go out for dinner tonight? But being married long enough, you know how the other person thinks. She says, I know where he's at. And she goes to the garden, and sure enough, there is Solomon. And when Solomon saw her, chapter 6, verse 4, this is beautiful. Look what he said. Thou art beautiful, O my love. Wow. Do you know what he did, folks? The wisest man who ever lived. He understood the cure for a conflict in a marital relationship. And do you know what the cure is for the problems that you may be having in your marital relationship? It's when we learn to forgive one another. It's true. If we're going to have a good relationship, or if we're going to have a good marriage, you've got to have a good forgetter. You've got to be willing to forgive. I heard about a grandpa and a grandma who had been married for 65 years, and the granddaughter was listening to her grandma tell her they've been married for 65 years, and the granddaughter paid attention. She said, Grandma, how did you stay married for 65 years? And Grandma said, well, honey, your grandpa and me, when we first got married, we decided that there were 10 things that I would overlook in your grandpa. 10 things that I just decided I would overlook. And the great-granddaughter said, she wasn't a great-granddaughter. Granddaughter said, Grandma, can I see that list? I want to put my hands on that list. She said, honey, I never really made a list. But she said, every time your grandpa messed up, I just said, you better thank God that's on the list. She understood forgiveness. I want to make three quick statements about forgiveness and then I'm done. Number one, why do we need to forgive? God commands it. Be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Ephesians 4:32 says, God commands it. Let me tell you a second reason why we need to forgive. Unforgiveness will destroy you. Unforgiveness will destroy you. The Bible says in Hebrews 12:15, talks about the root of bitterness. And the third reason why we ought to forgive is because we forgive so we can be forgiven. Matthew 6:12 says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We forgive so we can be forgiven. And if I want God to forgive me, then I better forgive people. If you say, I'm not going to forgive him after what he's done, no way. I'm not going to forgive her, then you better make sure you don't need forgiveness. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. You better do what Corinthians says and keep no record of wrong. Quit bringing up. Quit bringing it up. Process it, bury it, and go on with your marriage. Go on with your life. Quit bringing up old grievances. Now, the most important thing I think I'm going to say in this message, and then I'm done, and here it is. Forgiveness. Why should we forgive? Forgiveness is an act and a process. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and it's a decision, but it's also a process. Now, let me explain. Let's say, hypothetically, you buy your wife a very expensive diamond necklace. You made a decision. It was an act of the will. You bought her that necklace. Then you popped out the card, the credit card, where you made the decision. That was an act. That's what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is when you made a decision. It's an act of the will. But it's when you say, no, I'm not going there anymore. I'm going to forgive. I've decided I'm going to forgive him. I've decided I'm going to forgive her. And see that it's a process. And that necklace that you got, when you laid out that credit card, guess what happens? 30 days later, and 30 days after that, and 30 days after that, it comes back. And so you've got to learn that forgiveness is a decision, but it's also a process. It will come back up. And when it comes back up, you've got to say no. I'm not going there. I've already made a decision, an act of the will, to forgive. Because forgiveness is not just an act, it's a process. So this thrilling story of Solomon and Shulamite. They were in an ideal marriage, the first four chapters. In chapter 5, that ideal marriage became an ordeal marriage. And Solomon was wise enough to solve the conflict with Shulamite. And he provided a cure. And she provided a cure. And so, in a marital relationship, there will be a cause. There will be a problem. There's going to be some chaos. But there's also a cure, folks. And the cure is when you say, yeah, we've had some problems, but I'm going to forgive you. And I'm not going to bring it up. I bury the hatchet, so to speak. And we'll move on in our relationship. And we are going to be the better because of it. You see, folks, a simple message. from God's Word will enhance and enrich your relationship. And if you are single and looking perhaps for a relationship, I would encourage you to be sure to find out what God's Word says about marriage. Solomon and Shulamite learned something that was very, very important. And I trust that we all will learn these timeless principles out of God's Word.